are listening to Sean of the Scythe, and I'm your host today, Sean Dietrich, coming to you live from the podcast airwaves and the radio waves all over this fine nation. This episode brought to you by Case Knives, a tradition of my family dating back to my granddaddy, who once said the best cure for idle hands was to build something. So keep your hands sharp with a Case Knife. And by Folklore Brewing and Meadery, quite literally the best brew in Alabama with the awards to prove it. Visit folklorebrewingandmeadery.com. Also by Midnight Shift Coffee, a Pensacola's own official brand of coffee. A buck from every bag goes to support the Rally Foundation, which helps to fight childhood cancer. Visit midnightshiftcoffee.com. Well, I am recording today sort of under surprise. I was kind of hoping to, not hoping, I was thinking of taking a break with the podcast because, boy, I tell you, I've just gotten flat lately. Ever since the world just kind of took a downturn, you turn on the news and you see the worst things that society has to offer, at least, you know, in the past few weeks, where people are knocking over cars and lighting them on fire and busting up shop windows. And, well, the protests have gotten a whole lot more peaceful. But I want to tell you, there for a little while, I was kind of depressed, I guess. It was maybe the most down I had been since this whole four-month quarantine started for us. Couldn't shake it, you know. I'd turn on the news and I'd see these riots in Italy. I'd see these riots in Brazil, Africa, Germany, France, the U.S., Arizona, California, Nevada, Wyoming, Kansas, Texas, Pennsylvania. I mean, they were. It was worldwide. And you just got the sense that, it just got me down. You know, man can be just so unjust toward one another. But enough about that. So I simply mentioned on last week's podcast that I thought about pulling the plug, and I was serious about that. It's hard to get the emotion up to do something like this when it feels like the whole world's falling apart. It feels so shallow, you know. Why would anybody care about what I have to say when the whole world is under turmoil? So I shared that, I guess, on last week's podcast, and I got flooded with messages, your messages, from kind-hearted people who asked me not to do that. God knows why they asked me not to do it, but they were so nice and so kind. I even got some messages via snail mail asking me to keep it going, and I got a real positive response. Maybe, perhaps, in the last year or so, I got the most positive response I've ever gotten, the most feedback on reading my essays. I had never read my essays before on this show, and we've been doing it for years now. And there's a whole lot of them essays, because I've been writing my column for just about 7 years every single day. It's a form of madness is what it is. And last week was the first time I ever read my essays, and I guess I didn't think anybody would really care to hear me read. I'm not a great reader, but we got a great positive response and requests to do it again. So here I am. I'm going to do it again. I'm going to read you some of the essays that I wrote from this past week, and may God have mercy on your soul. But now, before we start that, we're going to play something we're very lucky to have on this show. It's from the Library of Congress, dates back to 1916, recordings of the Tuskegee Institute Singers Vocal Group. We've got Alvin J. Neely, a tenor, Leroy Brown, tenor, Charles Edward Clayton, tenor, Alfred Taylor, a bass, William P. Smith, baritone, William J. Williams, tenor, William Wiley, bass, and now the Tuskegee Institute Singers.
Yeah.
I'm walking in the woods. I'm walking to a place where I've fished for a lifetime. I used to call this spot my honey hole. My honey hole. It's a secluded place on the bay where the live oaks drape over the water and the crushed beer cans are plentiful. Ooh, I love it here. I've made many important decisions at the honey hole. This was where I decided to apply for college. This was where I cried when a girl broke my heart. And this was where I officially gathered my courage before asking Jamie Martin to marry me. The honey hole. When I was sad, I would visit this shore and somehow feel hopeful again. You know, hope can be a fleeting thing. Trying to recapture it is like trying to catch a gnat with a pair of Barbie tweezers. As a young man, I would sit on an overturned 5-gallon bucket, holding a rod, listening to the sound of my spinning reel, and I would shut off my brain. The reason I'm at the honey hole today is because I need to clear my head. I need to think. The world has turned into a troubled place, and it's been hard on everyone. Since the novel coronavirus hit, depression rates have skyrocketed. Crisis centers are reporting a 40% leap. And those looking for help. Substance abuse is on a meteoric rise, and 4 in 10 Americans admit that fear due to the pandemic has wrecked their mental health. Well, I'm trying to take care of mine today. I stop walking. I can see someone is already at the honey hole. I hear voices in the woods. Childish voices. When I get closer, I see 2 boys sitting on 5-gallon buckets, but they don't see me. One boy has white blonde hair. The other is Latino with dark cocoa skin. They sit side by side holding fishing rods. I hear their little voices reverberating across the water, happy and strong. And the last thing I want to do is interrupt them. It ain't polite to interrupt a man when he's fishing. So I just listen to their conversation. What time we gotta go home? 4. My mom makes me help with dinner. Your mom lets you help with dinner? My mom gets mad when I'm in the kitchen. She's all like, quit eating the dang pickles. Yeah, my mom makes me cut stuff with a knife sometimes. You want to come over for dinner? I have to ask my dad first. Well, we're having chicken. My mom doesn't know how to make anything but chicken. Boyhood is beautiful. The lull of their gentle conversation is one that's familiar to my ears. I remember the cadence of childhood. I hadn't forgot its language. You know, I could probably even participate in their conversation if they gave me a chance. But I never get the chance anymore. I don't know how it happened. One day I was reading Superman comics. The next day I had lines around my eyes and osteoarthritis around L5 and S1. When people get older, we don't get all jazzed up about little things like we used to. Grown-ups talk about mortgages and headlines and how complicated it is to go grocery shopping during a pandemic. But I still remember earlier days. I remember passing idle hours discussing the intricacies of my mother's meatloaf and my disgust for red cabbage and the veritable hell that is congealed salad. The boy's laughter is so loud, it's probably scaring a fish. I'm about to walk away to give them some privacy, but something inside me is moved. Seeing them shoulder to shoulder, a white kid and a dark-skinned kid. They're happy. They're cheerful. And they're sharing. It ain't like what you see on the news. I needed to see this. Last night I turned on the television to see sadness on every channel. So I switched to the international channels. I was hoping to see a British mystery or a period drama with lots of costumes or at the very least a cooking show. But there were riots on those channels. The two boys are sharing a bag of Cheetos. The blonde kid reaches into the bag. He removes a handful, eats it, then licks his palms. The other kid reaches into the bag and does the same thing, licking his palms. They keep doing this, eating, licking, and so on. It's pretty gross. But it makes me smile. Because I finally realize what I'm seeing here. I'm seeing you and me. I'm seeing the best parts of us in kid form. I'm seeing something that is nothing short of profound. And behold, one of the sacred children imparts his wisdom by saying, "Do fish go poop?" "Go poop? Of course they go poop. But fish don't have butts." "Yes, they do. Everything's got a butt. Even ladybugs got butts." "How do you know that?" "Fish butt, fish butt, fish butt." And the other kid shouts, "Fish butt, fish butt, fish butt," just to hear how his voice sounds echoing across the surface of the water. And as if that wasn't enough, one kid adds his final punctuation and burps. I decided to leave them alone. This is childhood. It don't need my intervention. But my feet rustle in the underbrush as I walk away, and the boys stop their conversation and they're looking right at me. Immediately, I feel bad for ruining their insightful repartee about aquatic anatomy. I shouldn't have eavesdropped. The boys wave and they say, "Hello." They're very polite. I guess someone's taught them some very good manners. However, even if they are polite, if they offer me some chips, I will respectfully decline. I turn and face them and I say, "Did y'all catch anything today?" One kid frowns. "No." The Latino child says, "No, not yet, but I'm about to catch something." His friend shoves him. He says, "Oh, you always say that." The kid smiles. The Latino child has become half child, half messenger, though he is unaware of this. He says, "Hey, you can't give up just when it gets hard." And somewhere deep in my heart, I know that child was talking to me.
Never humble, humble, humble yourself. The bells are rung. Never humble, humble, humble yourself. The bells are rung. Glory and honor, glory and honor, praise the Lord. Never humble, humble, humble yourself. The bells are rung. Never humble, humble. Humble, humble, humble yourself. learn from and live a humble, humble, humble yourself to build and run. Glory and honor, glory and honor, praise the Lord and live a humble, humble, humble yourself to build and run and live a humble, humble, humble.
Middle of the night. The rural Alabaman countryside was lit by the glow of the full moon. See, in most major U.S. cities right now, tens of thousands are holding protests and demonstrations. In Washington, D.C., for instance, throngs lined the streets. In New York and Los Angeles, it was standing room only. A lot of world events happening right now. The June moon was completely full, and farmers used to call this the Rose Moon. Ancient Germans used to call it the Mead Moon, or the Honey Moon. But long before Germans had farmers or honeymooners, the Algonquin tribes that wandered North America used to call this the Strawberry Moon. Now, the Strawberry Moon was believed to be mysterious and powerful by the Native Americans and the farmers, and also by the sort of columnists like me. Michael's father, a third-generation Alabaman farmer, always told him that a strawberry moon was a magic thing. So, before bedtime, Michael went to look at the moon that night. And he wasn't alone, either. People were looking at the moon in Malaga, Spain, Genoa, Italy, Omsk, Russia, Paris, France, Des Moines, Iowa, Santa Rosa Beach, Florida. See, folks all over the globe were simultaneously watching the same heaven. And for a brief pause in time, just a brief pause, there was no such thing as the coronavirus or riots. Before bedtime, Michael put his 2-year-old pregnant cocker spaniel into the barn. Her name is Bama. She usually sleeps in their den, but not tonight. Because Michael had a feeling that tonight would be the night Michael's oldest daughter, Sarah, who's 8 years old, went with him to make sure her dad did everything right. She was asking a million pregnancy questions, like, what's going to happen if Bama has her puppies tonight? Or, Daddy, will it hurt? Or, don't you think Bama should sleep in my room just in case? They helped Bama into her bed underneath the barn's workbench. Michael placed a walkie-talkie baby monitor beside the dog. He let Sarah keep the receiver in her bedroom. That night, the family settled down for their long springtime nap beneath the light of the pink moon. And it was the same kind of restless sleep you experience on Christmas Eve, or the night before your own wedding. Pure excitement. Tossing and turning, and waiting. At 11:48 p.m., little Sarah came bursting into her mom and dad's bedroom, waving a baby monitor and shouting, "It's happening! It's happening!" And in a few moments, all three of Michael's daughters had dragged him off the bed, down the stairs, and into the barn, where Bama was panting and whimpering, lying on her side. Her mouth was open, her tongue was out, her chest was heaving, and she looked at her humans with that same helpless look that all mamas wear during labor. It's a look that seems to say, "This sucks." The family gathered around the dog and talked to her quietly. They said things like, "It's going to be okay, Bama. It's going to be okay." The girl stroked her fur. Bama's water broke, and this was followed by biological events that are way too messy to talk about. After all, this is a family show, so I won't describe these events by using graphic words like discharge or amniotic fluid or slimy membrane sac, because that just wouldn't be kosher. So all I'll say is that you don't want this stuff happening in your dining room. Michael said, "It hurt to watch. Honestly, it stressed me out, the whole thing." The first puppy made its appearance, and the family cheered. The girls giggled with elation. Bama's panting stopped for a moment when she grunted and pushed. And behind her appeared the miracle of yuck. Michael says, "I was gagging. I mean, I don't even want to tell you what Bama did with the placenta." And I'm grateful he left that out. Next, animal intuition kicked in. Bama cleaned her first puppy to stimulate its breathing and to start the blood flow. You know, to watch a mother dog care for a newborn purely out of her instinct is nothing short of reverent. Bama had four puppies. A fifth was on its way, but something was clearly wrong. The last puppy emerged, but it wasn't moving. Michael says, "It just laid there, and we all just looked at each other. It was like we knew." The girls started to cry. Michael was doing his best to cheer him up, but it's not easy explaining to children that no matter how pretty the moon outside might be, this world is not fair. In fact, it is a hard fact that when you get used to it as an adult, you just take it for granted, but life never gets easier. Bama kept licking her emotionless newborn pups until she finally gave up. She collapsed from exhaustion, and her breathing slowed. Her other puppies gathered around her belly to feed, but the fifth puppy was starting to get cold. Young Sarah lifted the puppy into her hands. The little girl's chest was heaving. She was sobbing. She said, "Can we name it?" Michael said, of course, darling." Then Michael's daughters crowded around the cold animal. One of the girls began rubbing the puppy's ribcage with her hands, whispering to it. Another began pressing her cheeks onto the dog's wet fur. Michael said, "It's no use, girls." And then he searched for the right words, because even though this moment was a helpless one, he felt he needed to say something. But no words were coming. Still, a father's job is to try to find the words, so he did, and he was going to say something about grief and loss, but he was interrupted by the sounds of girlish shouting and squealing. "Look, Dad," shouted Sarah. "Look, he's alive." And sure enough, that little animal began to squirm in their hands. And soon that animal was feeding from its mother like a professional. To say that this family was overjoyed would be a lie. They were moonstruck. Michael says, "It was the best night my family's had all year since this quarantine started. And with our world the way it is lately, we've just needed a little cheering up." Michael, you can say that again. Dear Sean, in my house, we're still recovering from COVID-19, and I'm getting over the tail end of it. I'm feeling much better now. My wife has been great the whole way through this badness by taking care of us all. We are originally from Mississippi, but I live in Pennsylvania now. Can you please cheer me up today? Sincerely, Bulldog in Pennsylvania. Dear Bulldog, I have here a story from a man I will call Pete. Pete wrote me a letter describing a unique wedding toast he received in 1982, and I hope it does make you feel better. The story begins when Pete was making an all-night road trip from Fort Walton Beach, Florida to Charleston, South Carolina. He was on his way to get married. His fiancée's family lived in Charleston. Now, they throw real, real fancy weddings in Charleston. They don't cut corners like we do here in Florida, especially in the Florida Panhandle. At my cousin's Florida wedding, for instance, the bride and groom wore matching camouflage outfits, and they cut their wedding cake, which was in the shape of a red turkey, with a buck knife. But see, in Charleston, they do things very, very differently. I have visited Charleston more than a few times, and frankly, I feel underdressed. So Pete was on his way north, and he would be arriving the day before his wedding. And no sooner had he gotten out onto I-10 than he saw this man hitchhiking on the shoulder. Well, Pete faced an immediate crisis of conscience when he saw the hitchhiker. On the one hand, Pete was raised Methodist, and, you know, Methodists required by federal law to pick up hitchhikers. On the other hand, Pete was in a hurry. So he pulled over. It was an old man with weathered skin and rags for clothes, and Pete asked where he was going. The old man said, "Don't care. Where are you heading, son?" Pete said, "South Carolina." The old man smiled, reached into his pocket, and gave Pete all the cash he had, which was only a few bucks. The guy said, "South Carolina's good with me." Now, if the story stopped there, it would be a great story about being kind to strangers and about how Methodists kick proverbial denominational butt and so on. But remember, I told you this story is about a wedding toast. When Pete got to Tallahassee, he stopped at a gas station. He was filling his tank when he met a man wearing army fatigues carrying a duffel bag. The man was unshaven and long-haired. He said he was on his way north and he needed a ride. Pete glanced back to his car and saw the other vagrant sitting in the front seat. Pete looked at the man with the duffel bag and said, "Get in." Soon Pete and his two new friends were cutting through the Georgia night, passing peanut fields in the dark. Now, they hadn't traveled more than 25 miles when they saw another young man on the side of the road sticking out his thumb. Well, see, now this was just getting weird. Pete was starting to wish he'd been born Presbyterian. The hitchhiker was young. He was a teenager. Pete asked the kid where he was going, and the kid said he was on his way to visit family in Virginia. And, well, anyone who's familiar with Methodism knows what happened next. Pete told the kid to buckle up. Pete tells me, "I just couldn't see how it was fair to pull over for one, but not the other." Thus, they rode across the great American South, jetting across the low country at night. Four complete strangers. Pete said it felt like he was in a very bizarre movie. A movie he sincerely hoped did not turn out to be a suspense thriller. Pete admits that he had fun. The four men had a wonderful conversation on the way to Charleston. Pete says he completely lost track of time talking about movies and music and books and all the other things people used to talk about before they got smartphones. And then, even though these men were complete strangers, and this is where the story gets pretty good, Pete got a little carried away with himself, and without first asking his future wife, he invited them to his wedding. When he got to Charleston, he rented the men a motel room for the night, which was no small fee. And the next day, he broke the news to his fiancée about his impromptu wedding guests. And as it turned out, his fiancée was very excited when she heard the news. And by excited, of course, I mean that her head rotated 360 degrees like the girl from The Exorcist. She said, "You did what?" between kidney shots. That afternoon, Pete and his fiancée arranged for the men to attend the wedding and reception. Before the ceremony, Pete took one of the men to a barber shop, and he also outfitted the men with sports jackets and trousers. Now, I'm running out of time here, but to make a long story even more tedious and boring, the wedding was a smash. Pete and his wife exchanged vows, and three men in the back pew sat shoulder to shoulder like Larry Moe and Curly. And at the reception, Pete recalls that, without a doubt, these three men definitely enjoyed the open bar more than anybody else. The best moment of the night came just before dinner, when the city's elite were raising glasses to toast the happy couple. One of the hitchhikers stood. He raised a champagne flute. Pete almost had a nervous breakdown waiting for the man to speak. The old man used a loud and sincere voice. But he didn't say much, and he didn't draw much attention to himself. He simply held that goblet high, and he said, "Thanks for the lift, Pete." Pete says that there was a deep emotion in the air. He also says that nobody in the ballroom had a clue what the old man was talking about, except for maybe the Methodists. Get well soon, Bulldog. Get well soon, your friend, Sean Dietrich. An email from Matt, who writes, "Sean, I'm confused about my future. I thought I had school all figured out before the virus happened. I missed my graduation because of the pandemic, and I'm thinking about dropping out altogether now. I just don't know what I want to do. Maybe you can help me figure it out. When you were young, what did you want to be when you grew up?" Oh, dear Matt. This is not an easy question. You see, I've wanted to be many different things. When I was a boy, I wished I were big. That's pretty much what all kids want. I just wanted to be like my grandfather. He was a big man that neighborhood dogs used to always follow around. I guess I wanted to do what big people did. I wanted to play fast-pitch softball, drive cars, pay bills, outrun the IRS attack dogs. When I got older, though, I wanted to have a skill. That's what I wanted. During the middle school years, everybody's figuring out who they are. Some kids show promise as artists and writers or athletes. Others are math whizzes, and they grow up to be billionaires and boss everybody around. Me? I never figured it out. Besides, even though I didn't realize it, all I really wanted was to fit in. There's a basic need young people have, just like the need to laugh, or the need to rupture their own eardrums with loud music. To fit in. After all, there's no suffering worse than loneliness. So I just wanted to blend, you know? I wanted to wear the same Chuck Taylors everybody else wore. I wanted the team captain to choose me at least not last for football. After my father died when I was a boy, all my life aspirations went out the window. And at that point, all I wanted to be then was safe. Plain and simple. I just wanted to be secure and not be afraid. But people grow up. Over time, I quit caring about security, or fitting in, or being big, or Chuck Taylors. And I just wanted to be a regular guy. And I know that sounds ridiculous, and well, it probably is, but being average is fantastic and filled with unspeakable pleasure. During childhood, I was the son of a suicide victim. During my adulthood, I just couldn't wait to be a run-of-the-mill guy. But then something changed in the aspirations department, probably about my late 20s. I was taking community college classes, and suddenly the world became much bigger to me. Community college can do that for a guy. I started to get the sense that Earth was a richer place than I'd ever thought. And I wanted to be a part of it. I remember driving home one night after a stern lecture. This is no kidding. In Earth science class. Earth science of all the classes. We had talked about the universe and how big it was and how vast. And I decided right there that I wanted to do more than just pay bills in my life. I wanted my life to mean something. And it was during that exact moment in heavy nighttime traffic that I saw a bumper sticker that read, "The meaning of life is to give life meaning." Lord, that bumper sticker spoke to me. So you know what I did? That's right. I went home and I did nothing and completely forgot about the bumper sticker for many, many years. But time marched forward and pretty soon I was feeling crummy again. And the worst part was I didn't know what I wanted out of life. See, life has always confused me. And the more it confused me, the more I blamed myself for it. Looking back, I think I was just trying too hard. And maybe you are too. See, I don't mean to be Johnny Downer here, but life itself involves a whole lot of striving. And it's in our drinking water. You can't get away from it. You strive and you strive. From the moment we're born, our parents are always showing us how to strive to be better. But one day this striving takes you over, and pretty soon you've forgotten what you were striving for. And then some people never quit striving. They strive to find a good job or a decent house. Others grapple to do something great in this world or be the best parent they can be. But no matter how you look at it, the striving is just downright exhausting. If you can believe it, just recently, I saw another bumper sticker in traffic that spoke to me. This bumper sticker read, "Be nice to your kids, they'll choose your nursing home." No, I'm kidding. I mean, I actually did see that bumper sticker once, but that's not the one I was going to tell you about. No, the one I read actually said, "Life got easier when I gave up." Wow. I love this bumper sticker so much that I jumped out of my truck at a red light. I knocked on the guy's window and I asked where he got it. And I'll never forget when he rolled down his window and smiled and then pepper sprayed me. The truth is, Matt, I've wasted your time. I can't answer your question, namely because I'm not you. In fact, I can't even articulate what I want out of life. I'm middle-aged, and that means I have a lot to learn, make no mistake. Each day, I realize that I know less than I did yesterday. But I suppose if I had to put into feeble words what I'd like out of my own life, it would be pretty simple. I want to be less selfish. I want other people to feel like they matter. And in this tense world, I want to be the kind of guy who neighborhood dogs follow around. Because even after all these years, I'd still like to be a bigger man. Zach and Kelly got married yesterday. They did their ceremony outdoors. Zach says the pollen was pretty bad. Yeah, the allergies have been rough in my area, too. I thought pollen season was finished, but there were huge yellow quilts of the stuff floating through the air, dusting my car, killing innocent woodland creatures, and inducing mild hallucinations. First thing that happens to me during pollen season is that my right ear gets clogged and I'm rendered almost completely deaf and cannot hear when my wife tells me to mow the lawn. Anyway, Zach and Kelly have been together for 5 years and they've done everything together, from riding go-karts and eating nachos to traveling through Europe and eating tapas in Spain. But they've never taken the plunge into holy matrimony. Now, I know all you women out there probably shaking your heads, saying 5 years. Jeez, Kelly, that's too long to wait. But all you men out there are nodding and sincerely thinking to yourselves, what are tapas? Zach explains his position. I guess I didn't want to give up my independent lifestyle and get married. Maybe that was it. Maybe. Either way, Kelly never pushed him. Even though her mother recommended putting on the pressure, Kelly simply waited and said to herself, when he's ready, he's ready. This is pretty exceptional on Kelly's part. I'm thinking here of my friend Bradley, a musician who wasn't sure if he wanted to get married until one day his girlfriend of 11 years tried to strangle him with his own guitar strap until he proposed. Zach says he doesn't know why he didn't propose. Maybe it was because his father left his mother and brother when he was still in the womb. He says maybe he just never saw a good example of two people being married. Well, Kelly couldn't have been any more perfect for him. A few weeks after their first date, they were doing everything together. They were always seen together, hanging out at the movies, going hiking, eating in restaurants while sitting on the same side of the booth. They were that kind of cheesy couple you see out in public who rubs noses together, giggling wildly. You know the sort of publicly affectionate couples I'm talking about. You can always spot the dating couples in restaurants. Dating couples often have animated conversations, and they talk real loud, and they laugh hysterically, and they kiss between each bite. Whereas people who've been married for several years can literally go an entire evening without speaking to their waitress. But getting back to the happy couple here. Zach was out of town for work when the coronavirus pandemic hit. The company he worked for went into lockdown mode and kept him in Wisconsin for 10 weeks, and he was in almost total isolation. He and Kelly did video calls. They also texted like crazy. But it wasn't enough. No matter how great technology is, it can never replace togetherness. Zach says, I thought I was going to die. I mean, literally die. I almost quit my job several times just to be with her again. Then came the big moment. It happened on an average Saturday. They were doing a video call, like usual, when Zach heard Kelly sneeze. He could tell from the video phone call that Kelly's nose was stopped up. He asked if she was okay. She said she felt fine, just a little tired, a little dizzy. Zach says, I was thinking the absolute worst. I mean, this is a scary time, you know? I thought she had the virus. The next morning, Zach quit his job. Then he drove several hours home. When he marched into Kelly's apartment, he took a knee and presented her with a small jewelry box. Kelly says that at the time, she was still wearing her Scooby-Doo pajamas and drinking coffee. She began to cry. Zach said, if you're going to get COVID, then I'm going to get COVID too. Kelly said, wait a second, COVID? I'm not even sick. Even so, she accepted his proposal before letting it lie too long, and she decided not to tell him that her sniffles were just springtime allergies. Their wedding was a simple affair as weddings go. They each invited a few people, but only a few. Each guest recorded the ceremony with cell phones for absent family members. Kelly says, we could hear a protest going on down the street while we said our vows. The preacher wore a black mask, and they all stood outside behind a local church. There was no reception, no party, no finger food, no cake. No wedding band consisting of four middle-aged guys playing electric guitars who still live with their mom. There was no chocolate fountain, no cheese fondue. Nobody made toasts, and nobody's uncle danced the electric slide. What they did was go home. Zach says, I made ice cream for her. It was kind of like our own private celebration. When he carried her over the threshold, they were welcomed home by the sound of a GE ice cream maker churning in the kitchen. They dished up bowls of vanilla peach ice cream. They watched television. Zach fed her a spoonful. Kelly returned the favor by smearing a gob onto his face. They had a small food fight, and their formal clothes were soon a sticky mess. They laughed. They cried. They rubbed noses. And they held each other until the sun went down. Kelly says, sometimes you meet the person in your life that you know your life is just going to suck without them. And it was all because I sneezed. I've never been so thankful for all this pollen. Kelly, speak for yourself. You know what I wish? I wish there were free pancakes for the whole world. Call me a dreamer, but I believe that pancakes slathered in butter and syrup are one of the secrets to a rich and happy life. Will the sugar rot out our teeth? Yes. Will the calories go straight to our butts? You bet. But we will be happy. See, growing up, whenever my mother made pancakes, she just knew it was going to be a good day. Not even hell itself can stand in the way of a man who's had his pancakes. Long time ago, I used to volunteer at this little church that always held pancake breakfasts for the homeless, the underprivileged, and the lonely. Several of us volunteers would spend a whole week stapling flyers to hundreds of telephone poles, and the flyer's message was simple. Free pancakes. The fellowship hall will be slammed with children, single mothers, old men in stained clothes, young men on their way to work, old women who lived by themselves, and they were all holding paper plates. It was as though everybody from 18 counties had come to have fun, eat pancakes, and get some good old-fashioned type 2 diabetes. So that's what I wish. During the midst of the troubled world we're living in, I wish everyone could have pancakes and forget about their problems for a while. Since I'm on a roll with my wishing, I also wish there were more old movies on television. Have you ever wondered what happened to all those old-time movies and where they went? Oh, sure, we got plenty of modern movies and modern actors who can't seem to keep their clothes on for two consecutive scenes. But where are the Charlie Chaplin and Buster Keaton movies? Come back, John Wayne. I miss you, Katharine Hepburn. There's something else I wish, too. I wish Lou Armstrong were played on more stereos. If for no other reason than because Louis Armstrong makes people feel good. I wish today's kids could learn about jazz. Over the years, I've met a lot of kids who have never even heard the word jazz. Certainly, they've experienced many other American things. They've played baseball. They've studied the Constitution. They've learned how to drive on the right side of the road and use their American digit when somebody cuts them off. But they can't name a single jazz standard. I once had a friend who was a former Auburn University professor. He was an elderly man when I knew him. He believed that jazz was the story of America. After all, to many of our ancestors, jazz wasn't just a musical style. It was an age. It crossed boundaries. It broke old rules. And it never hurt anyone. But enough about that. I can see several of you have fallen asleep, and I don't blame you. So I'm also wishing that one day, someday, perhaps in the far-off future, all yellowflies will leave Florida forever. I don't care where they go. They can go to Las Vegas for all I care and attend a George Strait show. Also, I wish baseball would return. I hope that when this pandemic is over, people will once again experience the thrill found in cheering for the same thing. It's a powerful feeling to be sitting in the nosebleeds, hollering your guts out with 42,000 true believers. One time when I was a kid, I was with my uncle at Fulton County Stadium to see the Atlanta Braves. The woman beside me was holding a walking stick, eating a hot dog. And I'll never forget when Ron Gant nailed a no-doubter into left field. The woman stood to her feet. So did I. Then we hugged each other and jumped up and down. It was a spur-of-the-moment kind of thing. The beauty of this was, we were strangers. Strangers who couldn't have been any more different. Me, a young redhead with buck teeth and freckles. Her, an old woman. But there we were, hugging, shouting. That's what baseball can do to people. Also, I wish that one day they would finally manufacture a vacuum that could please my wife. A few hours before I wrote this, I finished vacuuming our den, and I was very proud of myself, housekeeping-wise. But when my wife got home, she took one look at our floor and said, "Hey, when are you going to vacuum?" That hurt. I wish that people got less excited about celebrities and more excited about elementary school teachers, EMT nurses, and firemen. I sincerely wish that someday the grocery stores would carry tomatoes that don't taste like recycled kitty litter pellets. I would love it if they sold tomatoes that tasted like the ones from Mama's garden. Homegrown tomatoes are powerful things. Powerful. One good tomato has the power to change a man's life and make him weep openly. I wish that someday people would listen to each other instead of getting angry. I wish the injustices of this planet would finally be amended by the earth-shaking powers of decency and gentleness. I hope the same loving force that once cut the Grand Canyon, that sculpted Yosemite, and carved the mighty Mississippi would help us learn how to get along. And I wish that you could finally realize what a great person you are and how important you are to the grand symphony of life itself and how this world just wouldn't work without you. But until that happens, I'll just settle for some free pancakes.
Let my